Good morning, everybody. It is the first Sunday in Lent. One of the choir members back of the church wished somebody a happy Lent. I said a more appropriate greeting would be have an excruciating Lent. Okay, it's a time for fasting and repentance, and we will be dealing with that in these coming weeks. Are there announcements that need to be made this morning? Okay. Okay, there are two hands up there. Let's go this one first. Okay, yes. Very good. Anybody else with announcements this morning? I'm not seeing any hands. We will continue with the prelude.
Mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
O Christ, hear us.
In mercy, hear us.
God the Father in heaven,
have mercy on us.
God the Son, Redeemer of the world.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Hear us, peace. Amen.
O Christ, hear us.
In mercy, hear us.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord God, you led your people through the wilderness and brought them to the promised land. Guide us now so that following your Son, we may walk safely through the wilderness of this world toward the life you alone can give. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The first lesson is from the book of Deuteronomy, the 26th chapter. When you have come into the land that the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance to possess, and you possess it and settle in it, you shall take some of the first of all the fruit of the ground, which you harvest from the land that the Lord your God is giving you, and you shall put it in a basket and go to the place that the Lord your God will choose as a dwelling for his name. You shall go to the priest who is in office at that time and say to him, Today I declare to the Lord your God that I have come into the land that the Lord swore to our ancestors to give us. When the priest takes the basket from your hand and sets it down before the altar of the Lord your God, you shall make this response before the Lord your God. A wandering Aramean was my ancestor. He went down into Egypt and lived there as an alien, few in number, and there he became a great nation, mighty and populous. When the Egyptians treated us harshly and afflicted us by imposing hard labor on us, we cried to the Lord, the God of our ancestors. The Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toil, and our oppression. The Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with terrifying display of power and with signs and wonders. And he brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. So now I bring the first fruit of the ground that you, O Lord, have given me. You shall set it down before the Lord your God and bow down before the Lord your God. Then you, together with the Levites and the aliens who reside among you, shall celebrate with all the bounty that the Lord your God has given to you and to your house. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Shadow.
second lesson is from Romans, the 10th chapter. The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Gospel according to St. Luke, the 4th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during those days, and when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread. Jesus answered him, it is written, one does not live by bread alone. Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, to you, I will give their glory and all this authority, for it has been given over to me, and I give it to anyone I please. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours. Jesus answered him, it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him. Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to protect you, and on their hands they will bear you up so that you will not dash your foot against a stone. Jesus answered him, it is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test. When the devil had finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Here we have we
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Today is the first Sunday in Lent. By the way, with the liturgy, there are important prepositions. And when it comes to the seasons of the year, there are three: in, of, and after. This is the first season in Lent. That means every Sunday is about Lent. When we get to Easter, it will be the Sundays of Easter. Every Sunday is about Easter. Well, every Sunday is always about Easter. But then we have after, the Sundays after Pentecost, the Sundays after Epiphany. We go to green. They're really part of ordinary time. But now we're in a special time, a very special time. Lent. So my task today is not just to read the text, but to read the text in a Lenten manner. Right. To read the text in a way that will help us to think about our lives during this holy season. And the text that I'm going to be reading today is the Psalm. Psalm 91, I'm going to be reading five verses. And you have an assignment. All right, as I read these five verses, what I want you to do is to think of one word, just one word, that typifies or summarizes your response to the words I'm about to read to you. Okay, so when you hear those words, what does it make you feel like? What emotion do you have? What one word comes to mind? Okay, are we ready? Because you have made the Lord your refuge, the Most High your habitation, no evil shall befall you. No scourge come near your tent. For God will give God's angels charge of you to guard you in all your ways. On their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the adder, the young lion and the serpent, you will trample underfoot. This is our text this morning. So, what one word came to your mind as you heard and responded to these five verses from Psalm 91? Any brave people out there want to share? Hallelujah. Okay. By the way, don't be honest, because there are no wrong answers. This is about your response. Okay, so hallelujah. We're not supposed to say that during Lent, but okay. Yes?
Refuge.
Saved.
Safe.
Peace. Okay, anyone else want to add? I'm going to add one. My word, I've been brushing up on my German lately. And so when I read this text, it was a German word that popped to my mind. And that word was wirklich. Really? No evil shall come near you? And what does he mean by no evil? He will guard you in all your ways, all of them? And how much will he guard you? He will guard you so much that he will send angels to make sure you don't stub your toe. And I thought, really? Really? In the 20th century, I know it's the 21st century, but I grew up in the 20th century. I'm still sort of there. In the 20th century, Jewish scholars, philosophers, and theologians, such as Martin Buber or Franz Rosenzweig, I also think of the famous novelist Elie Wiesel. Many of us had to read his novel Night when we were in school. These Jewish scholars, following the Holocaust, and please remember, the Holocaust was not an aberration. The Holocaust was a culmination. It was a culmination of thousands of years of pogrom and ghetto and inquisition and murder. And so these Jewish scholars demanded that Jewish people ask God what exactly he had in mind in Psalm 91. When those Jewish babies were being thrown into ovens, how was God sending his angels to protect them lest they dash their foot? How is God saying and proving, no evil shall come nigh you? Other people besides Jews can ask the same question, correct? The other night, Pat and I watched a movie called The Hate You Give. If you haven't seen it, it's a really good movie. You should take a look at it. And that movie is, in terms of our sermon today, saying that black people can ask a similar question to what Jews can ask. Has God always protected black people? What about LGBTQ people? Couldn't they say ditto? Where was God's angels? And even the most privileged of us, you know, like white males, perhaps in less intense ways, but we also can ask, has God fulfilled the promise of Psalm 91? And so during Lent, we are being asked to question things and to say, what does it mean to trust God? Trust God to do what? Or to ask the question from a slightly different angle, how do we continue to believe in God, no less trust him, after 10,000 years of human suffering and horror? Because still today, what Jeremiah said thousands of years ago, still today it's true. Magor Misabib, terror is all around. Horrendous suffering and horror are all around, every day. Now, this is where I'm glad that I'm a Lutheran. Lutheran theology is steeped, marinated in the concept of paradox. Reality is very rarely simple or easy. It's always difficult. It's always paradoxical. And so Lutherans keep Psalm 91 in one hand. No evil shall come nigh you. And in the other hand, we keep the theology of the cross. That to be a Christian involves suffering. Or, as, and those of you who are my age will remember this name, as the Jesuit activist Daniel Berrigan used to put it, if you want to be a Christian, you have to look good on wood. The cross is before us if we are faithful to the gospel of Jesus Christ. If we speak and witness and live that gospel. faithfully what will happen. Jesus promises us is the cross. Suffering is part of the deal. So how do we get a handle on this problem that we're facing today? How do we deal with this paradox? My wife is going to cringe at this moment because I'm going to talk about philosophy for a minute. She hates it when I talk about philosophy, but I'm going to. Ever since a German philosopher, he was Lutheran, by the way, named Immanuel Kant, wrote a book called The Critique of Pure Reason. This book, by the way, is called A Copernican Revolution by philosophers. In other words, just like after Copernicus, we could never think of the universe the same way again. After Kant's critique, we can no longer think of philosophy or theology in the same way. And what does Kant say in that book? He says, God is a word that no human being can understand, that no human being can define or explain. And if you think you can define it, the Tao Te Ching says, God is by definition that which cannot be defined. So if you can define God, it's not God. It's idolatry. It's something else. So for Kant, the problem that we're facing today is not just God. The problem is our concepts of God. And whether or not those concepts turn out to be a betrayal of God, or at the very least, a diminishment of God, a reduction of God. And in this case, in the case of Psalm 91, the reduction would be to think of God as a divine insurance policy, dedicated to insurance us even against stubbing our feet against the stone. Remember, the Psalms are not about God speaking to us. The Psalms are us speaking to God, expressing our desires and our wishes. God is not a divine insurance policy, Kant would say. God as a Greek omnipotent deity in the sky? That's a problem, not a solution. By the way, we're going to have another interactive moment here. By the way, you will note that Psalm 91, in fact, the very verses I read as our text, are quoted in the Holy Gospel for today. Remember? Here's my question. Who quoted them? Who quoted Psalm 91 in today's Gospel? Patricia? The devil! Satan used Psalm 91 to tempt Christ away from the cross. He said to him, you don't have to suffer. You don't have to have all of this pain and misery. Throw yourself down and the angels will bear you up. So Luke says today to us, you know, Psalm 91 can be a temptation. Psalm 91 can call us away from the cross and from God's will. And so Jesus rebuked Satan for quoting Psalm 91. And Jesus is proposing, I think, a counter-theology. A counter-theology to Greek supernaturalism, but also to Hebrew orthodoxy. You know, the one thing that united the Hebrew authorities, the religious authorities, they agreed on almost nothing. The Sadducees hated the Pharisees hated the Sadducees, they all hated the scribes. But they all agreed on one thing.
Jesus had to go.
Jesus was challenging Hebrew thinking as well as Greek thinking. Sadly, the church almost immediately forgot Christ's proposal for a counter theology and went back to supernaturalism and to false security. Now, what is this counter theology I'm talking about? Well, I mention it in every sermon, so you've heard it before. You know, I'm 48 years in the ministry now, and I think every sermon I've said this, and I will say it again here in 2 weeks. Here's Jesus' proposal for how we should think about God. God is love. That's it. Jesus says, you know, the 613 commandments, they're really only two. Love God, love your neighbor. Love. That's all you need to know about God. God is the power of love in this world. And whenever we love, God happens. God becomes incarnate. God is alive. And what Jesus is saying is that we put our trust, remember the issue is how do we trust God? We put our trust in this love as the only way to save the world, to salvage the world. Now, saying God is love is easy. I've done it in every sermon for 48 years. It's really easy to say. The hard part, of course, is living out the implications of that. Because God does not want us to believe that God is love. God wants us to be the love that God is. God wants us to be the body of Christ, the incarnation of love in the world. And so Luke, in my view, the hardest of the four Gospels, because Luke won't let us get away with the sentimental notion of love. He won't let us get away with love as a feel-good thing. I love everybody. Luke unpacks in chapter after chapter what this love looks like. And he says, this is a love that takes care of the poor. This is a love that's there for the weak. This is a love that stands with the oppressed. And therefore, it is a love that is willing to stand against the rich and the powerful. This is a love that includes all those whom the righteous ones cast out. Even though that will get the righteous ones pretty ticked off. They might want to crucify you for that. But this love asks us to be God's agents in the world. God's agents for reaching out to people who are devastated by having to live in a loveless, soulless world. So, how do I know there is a God? Remember we started with that in terms of my response to this psalm? How do we know that there is a God? And here I'm going to get 21st century, because I think 21st century theology, and especially theology being done by feminist theologians, is helping us to address that question usefully. The feminists have obviously read Kant. Because they say, we're not going to find the answer to where can we find God? How can we believe in God again? We're not going to find that answer in theological metaphysics. We're going to find it in Christian ethics. Christian ethics is going to show us who God is and where God is and what God is in our lives so that I will experience God in loving my neighbor. Can I go back to German one more time? It's interesting to me that in German, unlike in English, there are two words for to know. Right? So we have the one word, know. They have two words. The first word is wissen. Okay? And that means intellectual knowledge. Knowledge of facts. Where geographically Washington, D.C. is, you would use wissen. Okay. What time it is. Factoids. Wir wissen such. Immanuel Kant says, when it comes to wissen, we do not know anything about God. God cannot be reduced to a fact. God cannot be reduced to an object. Right? And whenever we do that, it's not God, it's idolatry. But there is a second German word for to know. Kennen. And that means not intellectual knowledge, but personal knowledge. To know another human being. To be in a relationship with someone. And I might not be able to explain them, but I know them. In Lutheran theology, that's how we know God. Not wissen, that's arrogance, but kennen. I can be in a relationship with God. By the way, in Hebrew, this is even more radical. The Hebrew word for knowing God is yada, which is the same word as the word for how a person knows another person sexually. That most intimate of relationships, that knowledge, person and to person knowledge, that's the only way to know God. Kennen, never wissen. And so Martin Buber, in his great book, I and Thou, says, love is not something that happens in us. Love is always something that happens between us. When we close that space that separates us by reaching out and touching each other, that's what love is. God is between us, calling us into relationship with one another. And when we do that, we know God. We experience God. And all that metaphysical theology becomes unnecessary. Jejun. The Lutheran theologian Dorothy Sole, again, another 20th century figure, really important in the 60s and 70s. She was a radical feminist social activist theologian. She said something that I find very powerful. She said, Jesus Christ is the exegesis of God. Jesus Christ is how we know God. So if somebody asks a Christian, at least one who's heard this sermon, how
how do you know there's a God? How can you possibly know that? We answer, Jesus. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray. Seeking the grace, mercy, and love of Almighty God, we offer our prayers for the Church, for people in need, and for all of creation. Holy and steadfast God,
Through our bishops Elizabeth and Richard, our presiding minister Peter, and our deacon Manuel, as those who proclaim the faith, keep your word near to us, planting it in our hearts and in our communities. Make it blossom into proclamation for all people to receive. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
As you give your spirit freely, so also give bread that sustains every living thing. Graciously feed hungry souls and hungry stomachs with your bountiful provision. Lord, in your mercy, stir up courage among your people to resist oppressive powers and to lead people into freedom, as you did through Harriet Tubman and Sojourner Truth, whom we commemorate today. Shine the light of your justice through their work. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
May our baptism into the body of Christ call each of us to bold and dedicated ministry. Especially bless the ministries of Tom, Betsy, Manuel, Samuel, the community of Santa Maria, Valerie, and Renee, and all who keep the daily activities of Augustana going throughout the week. Lord, in your mercy, hold tightly those who grow weary in their struggles with addiction or temptation, through physical and mental illness or grief, through economic or job difficulties, through life change and transition, especially those who are part of the Augustana family experiencing Ronald and Ruth, and for others of our community, Betty, Bob and Alice, Thomas, Randall, Edith and Warren, Alex and Olivia, Carol, Rosa, Lou, Pearl, Herman, Lynn, Eddie, David, Renee, Eric, Chuck, Margaret, Ingrid, Graciela, Craig, Norma, Barbara, Carol, Deborah, our friends and family members, John, Lori and Doris, Joan and Burl, Amy and Chris, Lewis, the Kaplan family, the Knight Mint family, Riley, John, the Lyons family, and those we name aloud or in the silence of our hearts. By your strength, bear them up to live fully in your presence. Lord, in your mercy. Remind us of the stories of our faith that we know by heart. As you accompanied our ancestors in their uncertainty, so heal and guide Augustana into the future. Lord, in your mercy, provide comfort, strength, sustenance, and protection for those suffering as a result of natural disasters, and all those, also those enduring injustice, prejudice, and violence as a result of civil, institutional, and governmental abuses, both here and abroad. Especially those recovering from the California flooding, for those who have lost loved ones in the Ethiopian plane crash, those caught in the turmoils in Venezuela, India, and Pakistan. Lord, in your mercy. When we struggle and are tested, redeem us by the endurance of Christ. May we be guided and encouraged by the witness given by those who have gone before us and lived the faith at great risk, especially Mary, Margaret, Novella, and Teofilo Jr. Give us steadfast faith to strive for your glory until we witness its fullness at the great heavenly banquet. Lord, in your mercy.
Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Peace be with you. God's peace. Peace be with you, God.
peace. Peace. Peace be with you. God's peace. Peace. Oh, my pleasure. Peace, Vince. Oh, thank you. God's peace. Oops, I almost got your hand. Peace be with you. God's peace. Oh, peace be with you. Thank you.
sacrifice of our praise and thanksgiving and the offering of our lives, that following the way of the cross, we may know the joy of the resurrection through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare the way with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting, and your faithfulness endures from age to age. We praise to you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise to you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the wilderness to the land of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ. Praise to you for your Spirit poured out on all nations. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life as we proclaim the mystery of faith. God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence. Come, Holy Spirit. Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread. Raise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Breathe new life into us. Send us forth, burning with justice, peace, and love. Come, Holy Spirit. And with your holy ones of all times and places, with the church on earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever.
Amen, 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 amen. Our Father in heaven,
come to the banquet, for now is all ready.
Thank you.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in grace. You have fed us with the bread of heaven. Sustain us in our Lenten pilgrimage. May our fasting be hunger for justice, our alms a making of peace, and our prayer a song of grateful hearts. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Thanks be to God.